You got to make money today. That's got to be your attitude. Okay. Okay. If you got nothing better to do, then you can go to Columbia University or something like that. No, my wife went to that school, so I've been, you know why? I've been chiming on her for a while. Good morning, Corey. Morning, guys. I got a little real estate I can show you guys here in a second. We're going to talk. Today is role play Monday. I like to do a lot of role plays. And I think the key to success, hope I'm hitting, did I hit that record button? Yes, I did. I think the key to success, my success is based on, I talk to people every day. I make offers every day. Okay. I think that consistent behavior is so important. I think you have to understand the psychology of persuasion. How come some, I call them the one percenters. How come some people can just sell and sell and make tons of money? And Corey, tell that story about the guy you went on the road with a week ago. You mind share? You got to unmute yourself. Share that story you told me about the guy who made $250,000 in 1 month. That's
Yeah, it's talking to people and delivering an effective message when you're talking to people and uncovering what their challenges and then trying to find a solution.
Tell that. Can you mind telling that little story about that fella you went on the
Oh, I
road
was,
with? You were
yeah,
amazed.
I've been vetting an opportunity, so I feel the best way to go do it is go shadow someone and seeing, if they're delivering on what they're saying. And so for like me, I shadowed the gentleman for a couple of days to see, his message, what he was doing. And like I said, it's just getting in front of people and talking to people. And then a big thing with that was referral base is the kind of niche that I'm looking in is basically referrals and then just building up on that and
Oh
then just
yeah.
kind of snowballing.
We're gonna oh yeah, referrals are a great way to get warm leads. It should be part of your marketing plan. I'm think one of these Mondays we're gonna talk about the art and science of referrals. How do you get referrals? How do you get quality referrals on a consistent? I mean, referrals are they're great because they're almost like warm calls.
Well, also he incentivizes a lot of the people. He gives them kickbacks. So you can look at it as if you're going to put it into marketing, but you incentivize people to bring you leads
I
instead of
don't
getting
think you
kickbacks.
want to use the word for my lawyer hat came on. I don't think you want to use the word kickbacks. I think you want it has a negative
You are 100% right.
connotation. You might want to use the word creative commissions. Let's
There you go. Sorry.
how about that?
Just
We got
noted.
to go ahead.
I said I noted that one for you.
But didn't
Yeah.
that guy blow you away? You were on the road with a true great salesson. And I think that you said a quarter million in 1 month or something like that in gross sales.
Yeah, but the product sells itself. So that's one of the things too. It's when you're able to do the things and save people money, it's a pretty good, the product has a lot to do with it too.
Hey, Eric, good morning. Eric Backe, how are you? Good
Good
to see
morning,
you,
doing
buddy.
great. Yeah.
Hi, good to see you. One of the new guys in the group. Introduce yourself.
Hey, I'm Eric. I'm trying to flip dirt in Charleston, South Carolina. I fancy myself as a developer, buying infill lots and simple subdivides within 40 minutes of Charleston.
Excellent. How do they reach you? Somebody wants to do a
Email or
land deal.
yeah, I mean, phone number 843-834-8321.
Put it in the
Email, I'm Eric
Nobody
at
memorized
Landbetter.
that. Put it in the
Oh, yeah.
chat. Put it in the chat
Interesting.
there. That'll be great. That'll be great. Chris, the legend, also another legend, Chris Logan.
Hey, Claude, how you doing?
Good, man. Did you have a good week?
I
Anybody
did. I did.
make some?
I got a little punched in the gut last week, though. I had a 25K sale on the line, and they put down their deposit. Everything was good. I wanted to put them through the financing company I have, and they were denied on funding. So now what I'm going to do is going to go back to them for a more creative solution, and see if I can get that going again. Because they still want to do it. It's just getting them back on the hook with coming up with a payment program that can work for them.
Oh, okay. And sometimes, yeah. That's a good role play we should do today.
Sure.
What do you do? The greatest thing about being an entrepreneur is it's your business. You can do whatever the hell you want. Okay.
Yep.
You get, you know, and you know, you guys know that I love real estate. In fact, I'm going to show you some real estate. I showed it on Beer with Claude last Friday, real quick. I'm in the Soviet Socialist state of Southern California right now. It is gonna. It's sunny and beautiful, isn't it, Corey? We had a good. We had a good day finally.
Yes, we did.
Yeah, and it's gonna.
I was
stay
down
like
your way
that.
Yesterday.
Yeah, it's gonna stay like that. Yeah, yesterday was just cold and windy, man. I go swimming every day, and when I come out of that pool, man, and we got a 10-mile-an-hour wind, and it's not 80 degrees. Your uncle Claude. Your uncle Claude kind of transgenders, if you know what I mean. You know, this is not a family show today, is it? absolutely. let me show you guys something. Let me share my screen with you, and then we'll go to open forum. You guys can ask me anything, share anything. I just want to show you some. I'm in San Diego, and I do check on my I have properties here, and I went to a open house. And I should have hit the price on this property. I'll share you. I have purchased three of these properties years ago. Guess how much I bought them for 25 years ago?
250. Oh, back then, probably 200.
170 and 180.
All right, I was close.
Okay, and I went to an open house in the development. It's a nice 70 unit. It's a really nice little housing development. Very simple homes, but very nicely laid out. 1,570 square feet. They now sell, or they're listed for $799. And my properties are all free and clear, by the way, on this property. How can a home go from 170 to $799? In 20 something years.
Appreciation, baby.
It's
inflation, baby.
It is all about the real it is inflation, it is real estate, it is supply and demand. What happens when there's a demand? People want to live in sunshine states. A lot of people retiring, a lot of boomers living in sunshine states.
There's limited supply, so there's more demand and drives up prices.
More demand. What did I hear this morning on NPR? One of the biggest problems for people now in California is not affordability. They can't get insurance on some properties because of all the fires they had a couple years. Anybody else have that problem in their area? The insurance is the issue right now. That was surprising.
Well, that's because from the electrical companies, because they don't take care of all the. That's a whole other thing, but that's where a lot of those fires came from.
Yeah, I just heard. What else is moving out of California?
Some of these property insurance companies are moving out of California.
Yeah, California, because so many regulations, so many fires, we had flooding this year. Guess what the insurance companies are doing.
They don't insure you in California.
Yeah, that could be a problem. Joseph, you had any insurance issues there in South Carolina?
Not so far. It went up a little bit, but not significantly. And so far, no problem.
I see that interest rates, insurance, affordability. These are all new problems for. These are all problems for us for those of us in the real estate industry. Absolutely. Let me see. I think I have something else I want to show you guys. If I can find it. Bear with me one second. Here's a fun thing. You guys know I love to share videos with you. Let me share this. Somebody else came in the room. This will get a little political and then we'll move on, I promise. Did you guys see this?
This is a Fox News alert. While campuses struggle to get control of their students, at UNC Chapel Hill, they are bringing order back. students restoring the American flag and singing the national anthem after activists replaced it with a Palestinian flag.
So they then went on to GoFundMe so they could have a kegger. Who wants to guess how much money they raised?
Lots and lots of money.
Probably over 100,000, I'm just guessing.
You guys see my screen?
Oh, half a million, huh?
Jeez. Yeah. Holy moly.
That was in
That'll be one heck of a kegger.
They're going to get a good premium beer.
Are you kidding? They're gonna do Natty Ice and just invite more people.
That's a lot of pizza, pretzels, and foreign beer, Dos Equis, right?
Yeah.
I think what a great country. I love the American flag behind you, Justin. I think that's great, man.
We're in America, right?
Yeah. Oh, only in America, because you know, we're a lot of us are the silent majority and we don't like things, but we're not going to go out and burn buildings or protest or anything. But when we see the kids raise the flag, where people donated $20, $500, and literally in 72 hours, and I like Annette's got her for a flag up too. That's great. It's $500,000. They said they're going to have a real big party, but they're going to donate the rest of the money to nonprofits that support cause. So good kid, good kids, good kids. Little political there. Sorry, I don't go there too often, but I wanted to share that story. Let's go to open forum here. Who's got a question or a role play?
So Claude, actually there was a situation I had this past week on another sale.
Okay.
So this was going to be a $10,000 sale, and she applied for funding and she was approved for it. But then she comes back and she basically says, hey, after thinking about it, you know, $10,000 is a lot of money. And, you know, I'm already invested in other programs. And what I think I'm going to do is instead of investing another $10,000, I'm just going to go back and get results of the programs that I have. Right. And So what I told her was I told her that, give me 1 second. I'll tell you exactly what I told her.
Let's ask the group. What do you think? Anybody, what do you think he should have told her before he gives us the answer? What do you think he should have said?
She was getting results in those other groups.
Is that called buyer's remorse?
Yes.
Is that a psychological problem for us and for us entrepreneurs, gut salespeople?
Yeah.
Who's responsive? Yep. Whose fault is buyer's remorse, by the way?
Mine.
Yours.
Yep. So what I told her is I said, you know, I'm about to step into another appointment. Before I do, I want to thank you for reaching out. As I said before, I'm not here to pressure you. It's okay to say no to me. But you'd mentioned yesterday that you had a problem, and I believe I have the solution to that problem. You'd said that you were looking for a system to source your own deals and generate income and leave your corporate job within a year. You said if you were to try it on your own, you'd struggle with consistency and you'd be stuck into analysis paralysis, right? And she hasn't responded to me yet. So I was going to give her a call and just see if I could see what's going on with it.
Okay. If you could go back in a time machine.
Mm-hmm.
And I assume you were on Zoom or a phone call or something like
that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
If you could do it all over again, knowing that this lady was going, what did she text you or call you the date next day or something like that?
Yeah, she texted me the next day. Okay. We had a scheduled appointment at 4:00 that day to finalize everything. But she texted me that earlier.
Yeah, because she didn't want a confrontation,
right,
with you. So all of a sudden, she texted you. I'm sorry, I'm out of Q-tips and I can't make the meeting. You know, I got to go shopping, something like that. Right. Yeah.
Yep.
What would you do different if you went back in the DeLorean, Back to the Future time machine, and you knew ahead of time, that she's going to do this to you? What would be different in your conversation?
Well, I would have done 2 things. First thing I would have done is I would have collected a deposit. I didn't do that. So shame on me for that, number one. And then number two.
Skin in the game.
Number two, I definitely would have cigarette closer. You're not going to call me tomorrow and tell me that you've changed your mind and you don't want to do this or anything like that. You know, I would have kind of gone there with it.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I didn't do those things. That's why I didn't get it.
So
I remember this conversation.
See, you know, one of the best things you can do, we all make mistakes.
Yeah.
Is do. Good morning, lovely Abigail. Good to see you. Is when you is doing a do a diagnosis on yourself, a self-analysis. Hey,
yeah,
if I could do this all over again, how, what would I have said different? What would I have done different? One of them is skin in the game.
Hmm.
Okay, what do we mean by skin in the game? Anybody?
Get some money from them. So they have a commitment. They feel that they're obligated.
Get some money in the game, right? Should we also, you know, and we also love to use that scarcity thing that I always talk about. Okay. You know, you get somebody, let's do that role play. Let's pretend you got it on the phone again. Okay. Mm-hmm. You know, hey, Christina, I understand you had a change of heart and everything like that. And tell me what would you like to do?
Yeah. So, you know, I just got thinking about it. I'm invested in several other coaching programs, like I said before, and, you know, $10,000 is a lot of money. I just stick to those other programs.
I agree. So much money, so many other programs. Let me ask you something. This is your unique selling proposition, by the way, people off the role play. Okay. Well, the people I train, like Chris and Nitson and a lot of them here, Corey, I train, and Eric, I train them to utilize that one-on-one business model. This makes us very unique, and Justin also makes us very unique in the marketplace when we do that. So use that when you're role-playing with somebody. Say, you know what, Christina, I really appreciate that, and it's not a problem or anything like that. But you know what, these other programs, you and I have had two phone calls, two meetings on Zoom and everything. Who did you reach both times?
Oh, I reached you.
Okay. And do you think that makes it, those other programs that you're working with, do you work directly with the person who's doing the business that you want to learn?
Well, no. I mean, the other one's a really big company and they have like 7 coaches. And so I kind of get rotated between the 7 different coaches.
Okay. Okay. And you know what? Good for you. Those are good people, good programs. See, I only work with people who want one-on-one accountability. It's a true mentoring program. I don't know. You know, I work with people who want to see some kind of success in the first 30 days and want unbelievable accountability with private appointments, group training, and phone calls. That may not be what you're looking for.
No, I mean, that is what I'm looking for. It's just the money right now. You know, I've just spent
a
lot of money in this program.
Why do you think people pay me that kind of money?
Well, I mean, you're good at what you do. You're good at what you do.
I'm very good at what I do. So even if I could give you a guarantee, okay, mm-hmm. and work out some kind of financial arrangement with you, that wouldn't make a difference if I was crazy enough to do that today, right?
Yeah, I mean, that could possibly work, but it's just, you know, I'm really just, you know, I've invested in these other programs and maybe I just feel like I should focus on those.
Okay. So even if I guaranteed your success, you told me you have 2 kids in college. You told mm-hmm. me you're worried about bills and things like that. Mm-hmm. See, off the role play.
Yeah.
What would the average salesperson do at this point?
Give up.
Give up. Mm-hmm. When is it over, Justin?
It's over when I say it's over.
Can I have an amen from the group, please? Okay. What? Okay. What do a lot of salespeople do? They bail out when they get a few stalls or an objections or obstacles. They bail out, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yep. You don't have to bail out. You can take it out of the, you know, hey, now that it's over, can I ask, you can let them off the hook. You can use a little, you know, I'm so busy. I have so many people. It's not an issue. Don't even worry about it. So now that it's over, Chris or Christina, can I ask you one last question?
Sure.
Boom. And then go right back into the gut system again. You told me.
So you're just taking them around again.
You take them around again. It's over when you say so. The trouble is you have a money issue. And until I fix that money issue and I get you emotionally involved enough.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You know, that's the key. That's the key. Yeah. And then I even threw in a guarantee, by the way. My contracts have guarantees in them.
Mm,
on it. Okay. I can actually guarantee somebody in a and we're taught this role play, for those of you who are new here, we're kind of talking about the information business, coaching, consulting, mentoring. I think it's real important, no matter what business or product you, or service you sell. A lot of you are in real estate or solar or whatever, or life insurance or software. I think it's always important to know that if you're talking to enough people, can you monetize your time and knowledge in other ways? This is what very successful people do. Chris, talk a little bit about that. You have experience in that area.
Yeah, sure. So I've been wholesaling houses for the last 10 years, right, in real estate. And, you know, I've done it for so long, and I've just gotten to a point now where, you know, I have additional time on my hands where I can, because I have a team and, you know, I'm able to show other people how to get the results that we're getting and our clients are getting. So now I have a company called Virtual Wholesaling Made Simple, and we show people how to wholesale houses from home. It doesn't matter if they have a team, no experience, and less than $1,000 a month in marketing. But I love, you know, I can go out and get deals, but I love showing other people how to get the results that we've gotten and helping them break free from 9 to 5 and provide financial freedom for their families.
So what do most salespeople do in the business when they get the do prospects love free consulting?
Yeah.
Oh gosh, all day long, right? All day long. What do most salespeople, they love it so much when they get a warm prospect that they don't they just give everything away for free without thinking of the opportunity of monetizing that particular moment?
I can't tell you how many pick your brain calls I've had in the past. And then I look back and I'm like, dang it, I should have been coaching at that time.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Anybody want to do a role play on that? How to monetize the freebie prospect?
I'll do it.
It's a welcome to the Chris Logan Show. Hi, Mr. Logan. And what is the system? By the way, I teach the gut sales system. Do prospects have their own little secret system? By the way, what does the prospect really want, Daytrim? What does the prospect really want when they call us up?
Their problem.
Yeah. What else? Do they want freebies?
Yeah.
Do they want information? Do you think your competition gives it to them all day long?
Well, yeah, probably with free consulting.
Oh yeah. Let's go. Oh, Alex is in the building. Alex, I want you and Chris. You do this role play here. You guys do it. Chris is a wholesale a real estate investor and consultant, and you just saw him on a podcast, and you want to pick his brain all day long.
Okay, perfect. Get ready to get picked, Chris.
And you're gonna stroke him. You are gonna kiss his tuchus nobody ever did, because isn't that the system that a good prospect does?
Yeah, I got you. I've heard quite a few of those. So I think
he's gonna butter my bread.
All these analogies, man.
You cleaned this show up. Thank you. Butter my bread. I like that.
Hey, Chris, thanks for connecting with me, man. I appreciate all the content you've been putting out. I've been wanting to ask you a few more questions about virtual wholesaling. How do I get started, man?
Nice. That's amazing. Well, first of all, great to connect and glad you're enjoying the content. I always love connecting with people that follow my content and get value out of it. It lets me know I'm doing the right thing. So tell me, you know, what got you interested in virtual wholesaling?
I just want financial freedom, man. I'm tired of my job. I want to make more money. My problem is trying to get the money and trying to find these houses. Like what are your best marketing strategies to get these deals?
Sure. And, you know, happy to get into that. But first tell me, what have you done so far for marketing strategies to find deals yourself?
I haven't really done anything yet. Honestly, I'm just not sure where to start. That's why I'm hoping you can kind of give me a little bit of guidance here. I've heard about cold calling, direct mail, or a few of the channels I'm thinking about. I was wondering if you might have a letter that you could share with me.
Sure. Yeah. So, you know, what I have is I have this script that I can give you that'll kind of help you through those calls. But before we get to that, talk to me. So you said you haven't done your first deal yet. You're working on that. So, have you, Oh, you know, there's a lot of free information like on YouTube and things like that. You know, what makes you want to learn from me?
Man, you put out good content, and it just seems like you have all those stuff out there. I've actually just been thinking about just mm-hmm. following your YouTube and just trying to do it on my own. But mm-hmm. I wanted to reach out to you and see if you could at least give me a little bit of push, give me the letter, and just really find out like what's your best strategy to find these deals.
Love that. Hey, real quick, imagine for a moment that I could go ahead and show you a proven path to get started in wholesaling houses from home anywhere in the country, not only get the letter, but obviously just have a clear blueprint to where you want to go and how you can start making money consistently in real estate. That's not something you'd be interested in, is it?
Yeah, that's what I'm hoping you can share with me now is how I can find that path.
Hey, real quick, I have another call I have to get to here, but before I go, why don't we go ahead and set aside some time to do that? Why don't we do this? You wouldn't have some time at 3 o'clock today to connect, would you?
I have some time now.
Yeah. Are like you... I said, I got to get going here. I got another appointment I got to get to in a second, but, if you have 3 o'clock, I can go ahead and lock that in now and then we'll circle back and see how we can get you going.
Just to jump in here, a little move. Instead yep. of you giving him a time, mm-hmm. why don't you ask him what time today you can speak? And boom. Alex, you give him a time, and then Chris, no matter what time he gives, you're busy, but you're going to move. You're going to make an exception and move things. It's your grandmother's 110th birthday party, and you're going to, she'll be 111 next year, whatever, you know?
Okay. Yeah. Awesome.
Go ahead. You want to ask me, Chris?
Yeah. So what time would you be available later today? Or you wouldn't be available later today to connect, would you?
I can't do today, but I can a couple. So today's Monday. I can do Wednesday morning at 10 a.m.
Wednesday morning at 10 a.m. I'll tell you what. I have my grandmother's 110th birthday that morning. And wow. Unfortunately, I can't make it at 10 a.m. But I'll tell you what. You know, I could if I could work out 11 o'clock, that's not something that could work for you, could it?
I could do 11 on Wednesday.
11. Okay, well, let's book 11 o'clock on Wednesday, and I'll look forward to seeing you then. And by the way, I am going to have to rush home from this birthday. And so you're not going to, you're going to be there, right? You're not going to leave me hanging if I show up at 11 o'clock. You're going to be there at 11 o'clock?
No, I'll be there, Chris. I look forward to the Zoom link. Also, if you can get me that letter between now and then, I'd love to check it out, man.
For sure. I'll get that over to you, and then I'll look forward to meeting you on Thursday or Wednesday at 11 o'clock.
Okay, thanks, Chris.
Boom. Good meeting. Good role play. Give him a round there. That was good. Give him some fireworks or confetti, whatever. There. That was good.
I still haven't figured out how to do that.
Yeah. This is the thing. He wanted to just pick your brain for 45 minutes. We get these guys. Okay. And part of the process is you want to turn this around, keep it emotional. Well, gee, why are you interested in this business? What would you look to do? What do you do now? Yeah. And what's the dream? What would you like to see happen? Where are you? Oh, here's a good question. These are the questions you need to ask in the qualification step. Guts is 3 steps: agenda, qualification, commitment to close. The most important is the qualification because you're trying to find their motivation, their emotional quotient. And Mr. Pardo, round numbers, just to help me out here. Where are you now in this business financially, you know, and per month? And where would you like to be in the next 6 months, year? Can you give me a round?
We do on average couple deals a month, you know, probably anywhere between 10 and 20 grand a month.
That's fantastic. You're happy with that. You don't want any more.
No, I am looking for more. We're looking to scale up to 100,000 a month.
100,000 a month. Can you imagine for a moment if you found a solution to getting to, what do you think's holding you back from getting that 100,000 a month? Because you sound like a pretty sharp guy.
You don't know what you don't know. And so, I don't know if I need to spend more money on marketing, if I got to hire more people. I'm not quite sure what's holding me back.
See, off the role play, do you see what happens when you feign ignorance? Could you help me? Could you tell me what's your goal? What's the dream? What does the prospect do when you stay away from that formal presentation?
Yeah, they give you the answers.
They give you the answers. Yes, they do all the work for you. Hey, you know, and if you found it, and then you go into keep going in your qualification, besides their needs and greeds, are they the decision maker and do they have the money? So Alex, if you found a solution that would get you from 10, 20,000 a month to 50, 75, 100,000 a month, you wouldn't take action on that, right? You're not the decision maker in this company, are you?
Yeah, it's me and my partner.
Oh, okay. So if you found a solution, you would you act on it right away?
Yeah, for sure. I think so.
You knew to a substantial certainty that you over the next 6 months to a year were going to get to six figures. You wouldn't take an action right away, would you?
If you can guarantee me that, for sure.
I'm sorry, what?
If you can guarantee me I can get to six figures a month, for sure. Yeah.
Let's pretend. Well, listen to my words. Let's imagine. Let's pretend for a moment I could get you in writing and give you that guarantee. You wouldn't want to start working with me, would you?
Yeah, I mean, look, I was actually, I'm glad you brought it up, Claude. I was thinking if we could do deal splits or deal partnerships,
I don't do that. That's
Chris
probably
laughing because he gets that all the time, bro.
I don't do that. That's probably a deal killer, isn't it?
No, we're hungry. We know how to do deals. If you could just give us a little bit of coaching and guidance, we'll get the deals. Yeah. We can split them, and
I don't
we can
split
pay that way.
Maybe you didn't hear me. I got this horrible New York City accent sometimes. I don't split or partner on deals. I train people to keep 100% of their money. Is there something wrong with me?
So you wouldn't consider any type of deal splits or partnering?
What did I say before? It's a long silence, isn't it?
I wanted to see how you would handle that one.
Highly uncomfortable.
The showdown.
You want to know how uncomfortable it was? I have a wall clock here, and I could hear the. I mean, that's how uncomfortable it is. Okay, you just totally refused my open-ended question.
All of a sudden, right. Nitzan was typing, and all of a sudden he looks up. I saw Corey look up. Zach. And...
sounds like you should go first.
So back in the role play. So let me ask you something. Even if I could show you and your partner how to get to that substantial increase in income, and I'm not saying I could, but if I could get you there, just because I don't partner, that's a deal killer for us, right?
I mean, what does your program look like?
Boom. Now we're back in the sales zone again. Okay. Yeah. Is it okay? This is a great topic, by the way. Thank you, Ali. You never know what you're going to learn in role plays. You never know what's going to come up. Is it okay to draw a line in the sand with a prospect? Are prospects manipulative? Everybody, please say yes. Nod your heads.
Yes.
Oh. Do prospects, what happens if we're having a really bad month? No, we've had three bad months. No sales, no deals. How does that affect? And the prospect is, we got a hot prospect and they're asking for the kitchen sink. What does the amateur sales guy do?
Give it to him.
Gives him everything. Why? Because he's not coming from strength, is he?
Yes.
How should that salesperson always play? What's the role? Some of my new guys here are muted. Unmute yourself. What is the role? Role versus identity. That's from Dr. Byrne, B-E-R-N-E, transactional analysis. What role should the salesman play when he's had a couple bad months and he's got a hot prospect? Should he be just, I'll give you everything, or should he, how should he act? Come on, someone jump in.
It's a breathing exercise, right? Go ahead, Peyton. Sorry about that.
You should be walking away from that.
Walking away. No, he's got a hot prospect. Prospect wants everything. We are desperate for a sale. How should you as the salesman act?
You don't want to come across desperate.
Right. So how should you play?
Play, like you said, from the position of strength.
Abigail?
Well, if you think about it, if you haven't had a lot of deals for a while and you're thinking more in terms of scarcity, like you have no money, you're going to act that way. But if you kind of take the mindset that you've already, it's already done. I already made the deal. I have all this money. It's more from a mindset of abundance. And so you're
write that down. Somebody put that in the chat room. I love that. I'm going to quote you there, Abigail. The mindset of abundance. What is the biggest turn on to people in business? The beggar, the desperate salesperson, the guy who asks for the order five times, you know, the Ben Franklin close, the price goes up on Friday. Oh, we'll schedule you whenever you want. I'll call you back next week. Don't worry. Does that stuff work, or is it just a life of frustration? What was that phrase again about abundance?
Just the mindset of abundance.
The mindset of abundance. I love that. What's the biggest turn on for people? C word.
Confidence.
What is it? What's it like when we, not a braggart, not a bully, but we meet somebody who's confident, they're busy, they have social proof that we taught, they got a lot of customers, people are busy with them, they have very limited time, scarcity, they have an authority about them, that abundance, that confidence. Do you think people, that turns on people if it's done delicately?
Yep.
I think it's huge. I think it's you, especially the scarcity part, huh? I don't know if I can help you today, Peyton. I am so busy and I have so many clients. I'm scheduling for July right now on this. And tell me, why are we talking today, Peyton? What would you like to see happen in that deal you're working on?
I would like to get results.
When you say results, I'm not sure if I understand. I took a stupid pill this morning. What do you mean?
I'd like to 3X my business in the next quarter.
3X, that's a cute Grant Cardone state. I don't know what that means, 3X my business. Help me. You got to help me, man.
All right, we'll go back to what Alex was saying. I want to get to take my business to 100,000 a month.
Boom. That was a good role play, Peyton. Like I said, you never know what you're going to... Peyton and I had to go around, what was it, three times before he gave me a number. Okay. He said 100,000. Now I got a tangible number. And then I go back to, you know, what does it help to get the prospect to redefine what they want? And they give you these cute answers, don't they? Oh, I want to crush it. I want to do this. I want a 10X it, 3X it, all that stuff. What does that really mean? Do we know or do we make assumptions?
Assumptions.
Yeah.
You gotta have a number to 3X it.
Yeah. Do we now? Will the prospect tell us? You see, there's something beautiful that happens in a good sales conversation. When you ask the questions with the stroking, the nurturing, the redirection I always talk about, the prospect will, it's like they're on the couch and you're Dr. Freud. They will eventually, if you ask your question, I don't know what you mean. Could you help me out? I'm not sure if I understand. They will redefine and give you everything you want on a silver platter. You know what? Back in the role play, Peyton, thanks a lot. I hope you don't mind me putting you on the hot seat. This is the way we learn. We all learn, by the way. We all learn. And thank you for being brave enough to role play here.
Absolutely.
The thing about Peyton, when you say you want 100,000, is that a month, 3 months, a year?
Yeah, we want to do 100,000 a month.
100,000. And where are you now right now? Round numbers, just so I'm taking notes here. You don't mind me taking notes, do you? Because I love this.
Absolutely not.
You're sharing. What did I just do off the role playing?
Build some credibility.
What happens when you tell people you want to write down what they're saying?
Yeah, you're paying attention special. To them. You're listening.
What else? What do you think happens? What do you think's going on? And wow, I'm saying good shit. Claude's writing it down. Wow.
That he actually cares.
Yeah. Yeah. What happens when we acknowledge people, we listen to them, and we write down notes from what they say?
They tend to trust you more.
I think they have a feeling of greater
importance.
Don't they? Anybody here? My gurus in the audience here. When you do public speaking, all you guys out there, when you do public speaking to an audience, live speaking, isn't there always a couple people with these gigantic notebooks and legal pads writing everything you say down all the time? Did you ever notice that? They're writing every word down. And you didn't say anything yet. You told a couple bad jokes or something. You told what you had for lunch. And what are you writing down? Did you ever see that, Alex?
All the time, man.
Yeah. I had one lady and I was talking a big group, big real estate club. I'm speaking to the LA Real Estate Club on Wednesday, by the way. the Los Angeles real estate, Bill Tan's group, by the way. You guys know my style. And the lady raised her hand. I said, any questions? She said, Mr. Diamond, all you ever talk about in real estate and sales and everything, all you talk about is making money. I came to this seminar because I wanted to help people. I said, ma'am, I took the pregnant pause. I said, ma'am, that's the sickest thing I've ever heard. I got a good cheap laugh.
Hey, Claude, let me ask you a quick question, if I can jump in. With when you and Chris and I actually role played last week on our own, and he and I discussed this, but I'm usually accustomed to taking notes like on a Word doc or on their Podio lead. I've noticed you and Chris and some others actually, because I can type faster than I can write. So you obviously recommend, is it a preference thing, or you think strongly that it's best to write it down and show them that you're actually writing it down?
I think there's no problem. A lot of us, I always have an iPad nearby and things like that. And the notes are synchronized between all my devices. Apple has a wonderful application I'm sure Microsoft has it too. It's called Notes. Mm-hmm. Have you ever got? And I love that application. I use it almost every day for other kind of notes that I want to save and things like that. But I found for me personally that when I write things down, I just love a messy doodling notebook, and I write things down with a big fat Sharpie. I retain it better. Mm. I retain it better. Okay, a lot of times, like. I'll go with my wife. I think I shared this with you, you guys. We went to Barnes & Noble. She loves bookstores. We went there. I got a cup of coffee in the Starbucks inside. I brought my little notebook with me. It's so easy. And I outlined an entirely new mind map called the Sales Seduction. Okay. And then from here, I'm going to translate that to, I use a mind map application, Mind Node, NODE. And I'm going to make a little audio video package out of this. To me, pen to paper has a certain creativity and a retention quality to it.
Got it.
In my car, I have a notebook. I have a notebook and a pad. Okay, in next to my bed, I have a little notepad and a pen. Also, anybody here ever get a brilliant idea at 2:30 in the morning? Okay, you didn't write it down and you forgot it the next day, or you remembered it a couple days later. What happens when you write things down? You want to save. Sometimes when you're relaxed and everything, I exercise every day. You cannot believe the great ideas. I go swimming and running every day. Sometimes when I'm swimming tends to be very boring, but I get an idea, and in my little bag that you bring with your towel and goggles and stuff like that, I have a little pad that I use that I write things down on.
I started using this thing. It's called Remarkable.
Remarkable?
Remarkable.
Oh, show us.
I love that.
It's a digital notepad that you can, because I'm like you, Claude. I had notebooks and notepads everywhere. So now what this does is,
can you hold it against your shirt? Because we can't see it because of your background.
There we go.
What is that? Is that like a...
an iPad?
It's a digital notepad where you can write on it. It's digital. And then it can turn it into a text. And then with Wi-Fi, you can send it and it can download. But the cool thing about it is that... you see all these different squares?
Oh, wow. Yeah.
These are different notepads.
I love it.
For example, this is our calls, Claude. So every time we're on a call, I create another notepad and another notes, and I take it down. And so I've got calls with you. So different notepads, and it comes with a pen, and you can just write on it. And it's awesome. I love it.
Or is it called write on paper? It's awesome.
Yeah, it's like exactly writing on paper. It's called Remarkable.
I need that because I have 50 notepads everywhere.
What did that cost?
For example, So for example,
it's like $500.
Yeah. These are all my different, wait, where is it? These are all my different notepads. Let me see if I can.
Do you guys know if iPad can do the same thing or no?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
It's got to be an app or something.
There's an app you can get called Good Notes that'll do something very similar. Reason I got the Remarkable is because I didn't want something else that was backlit. I look at too many screens during the day. Yep. And my yellow pads were stacking up, and I had to do something different. So that's why I got that.
Yeah,
I have that problem.
Yeah. I just looked on Google Play, and I see Remarkable Mobile for the Android.
Yep, that syncs with the tablet.
Yeah, I use Notes. My favorite little device for a portable device really is my iPad Mini, and I can take notes. I can put a pen to this if I want and write on it and do a lot of things with it. And then I read a lot of books, so I can use Kindle and Audible and Hoopla and Libby. I can also read books on this. It's the size of a paperback, and it's just the most, I love this device. But, and my daughter works for, truth be told, my daughter works for Apple. So these are a little expensive. I think this is about $650, $700 retail, this little thing. And I get a discount from her, but I love this thing. When I travel, this is my go-to device in the airplane. Just because I can watch movies, I can write notes, ideas, I can write a book or do a mind map on it. All my applications work on it. It's a little bit more geography than just using the simple iPhone. This is good tips. And there's a question here from Nitsan. I'm having a hard time getting people to raise their hands to have a call with me. I have no book calls. Can you discuss this a bit? Okay, can you elaborate on that a little? Getting people to raise their hands. What do you mean?
So basically, I'm out there and I'm positioning myself. I'm putting myself out there on social media. I'm putting myself out there, different platforms, sharing with people what I'm doing and so forth. I've got my meetups. I've got things of that nature. I'm having a hard time booking calls. I don't know where to go to actually, like.
Nitsan, let me.
I'm putting out there a lot of social content. I'm putting out a lot of materials. I'm telling people, hey, if you want more information, or if you want my, you know, I have a mind map also that takes you from day one of getting started in multifamily all the way back and what it goes. It's huge. So I have a lot of the offering different things, and I'm offering them to people. Text me. If you want my mind map, text me if you want this, you know, call me if it, whatever it is. I've got no traction whatsoever. I'm not having phone calls with people. I'm not pitching. I'm not talking. I'm not doing anything. I'm kind of lost.
Nitsan, let me jump in. I'm sure there's going to be some other great suggestions here, but one of the things I started doing last week, in fact, Claude, can I share my screen for a second?
Yeah, sure. Let me give you
because this might be helpful for Nitsan here.
There you go.
All right. So let me share my screen with you. So what I started doing is I started joining all the Facebook groups of self-storage. And I put a post here, as you can see, and it was just a little intro about myself. I wasn't like saying, hey, I have a podcast, or hey, I have all this content. It was just a little about myself. And I put a few selfies of the storage facilities that I've purchased. And I wasn't expecting, I don't know what I was expecting, but I think I had, so half of these are my replies. So almost 30 comments, but the comments is not what's important. I think I had 14 people send me a message saying, hey, I've been looking to get started in self-storage. I have some questions. And that's resulted in, now granted, in all fairness, I haven't closed anyone yet, but I had 3 calls last week, and I have another 5 scheduled for this week. So the takeaway is join the different multifamily Facebook groups and just go there, do like an intro post, and then find 1 or 2 or 3 posts and just answer their question, like add some type of value. And I think inevitably you're going to have people starting to send you messages.
Yeah.
Yeah. I appreciate that, Alex. Thank you. And I've been doing that.
Okay. I'm and
I'm in members of like hundreds of multifamily and real estate groups. And I got post it. In that, and that's the, and that's what I'm, and that's exactly kind of my point, is that I am posting in them. Huh. I am adding value. I'm answering people's questions. I'm getting nothing back to where I can actually tell them, hey, come and, you know, let's set up a call.
Experiment with different giveaways, call to actions. Let me share something.
Thank you, Alex, for that. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
Man, anytime.
I call it, let's see if I can find it here. If you don't have...
Alex, if you can tag me on that post, I would appreciate that.
Yeah, happy to do that.
Thank you.
Can you guys see that? This is a book I wrote the end of last year. And if you don't have it, it's a 30-minute read. It's a whole package I have. But I believe I utilize, and Alex just explained it, something called guts marketing is attract leads rather than spending money or chasing really low quality leads or people who have, it's better to attract the leads. And if anybody wants this book, I'm in a generous mood today. Send me a text there, 619-206-5960. I'll send you this book for free so you don't have to pay for it. It's a 30-minute or two bowel movement read. Okay. Just want to see if you guys are listening, if you're paying attention. Okay. how you doing, Brent? We got a superstar. We got a superstar in the audience here. I think if we can attract people by going, see, your competition is doing, this is a real secret. You guys are going to get this for free today. Your competition is spending all the money doing all the work for you. Do you know how much money they spend on pay-per-click to build up these monstrous groups and podcasts and things like that on Twitter, on Instagram, on TikTok, and on Facebook, a lot of stuff on Facebook. So if you are selling aluminum siding and you go into the aluminum siding webpage on Facebook, and there's 5,000, did you ever see the size of some of these groups, by the way? Aren't they monstrous? They're huge. So if you're most of you guys are in real estate here. So if you go in your particular area of real estate, wholesale, storage, whatever, notes, lease purchase, my favorite. You go into those web pages and you answer a few questions. You have to be indirect selling. You cannot do direct selling because they'll kick you off. But you can be very stealth and you can go in there like, you know, Alex was just talking about. You go in and you answer a few questions and then you give something away for free, a free contract or my three favorite passages that should be in every mobile home contract. Or here's my new white paper. It's 5 pages on 16 ways to close a deal in 30 days or less, or questions you should ask your real. Oh, you make up different things that you believe that audience is interested in. And then they text you or email you. Okay. Now, do you have the right to contact them? Yeah. You can do that. Whereas is let's see if Brent, are you still there? You're muted, buddy.
Yeah, I'm here. That's awesome.
I wanted to give you a plug because I know you're having a seminar next week. And are there seats still available?
No, we don't. We don't have seats. I'm sorry. I had something in June out in Denver, your neck of the woods. It's milkandhoney.com. Anybody wants to reach out, we're going to be driving supercars and talking land investing. I believe that's June 26th and 27th. Thanks for the opportunity. But yeah, me, Joe McCall, and Ray Jung, we put that up for one day, and we were only supposed to have 25 spots and 38 tickets sold. So we might be in a little trouble with Topgolf, but it's okay.
What a good problem to have, right?
Yeah. We're going to get Joe McCall. So
what is that? What is that? When you tell an audience, what did he just do to us, by the way?
If I was doing it on purpose,
if I called up Brent, quick role play here. Brent, hey, Brent, I heard about your seminar with Joe McCall and Ray Zhang and about land and man, I want to go to that. I live right nearby. Can you squeeze me in, please?
No, I'm sorry. I can't. We're sold out. I'd love to help you, Claude.
I live 5 minutes away, man. I'll stand up in the back of the room or whatever.
Well, I'm humbled. But I actually do have another event. I'll drop it here in the chat. Use promo code Brent for $500 off. We're actually going to be, we're going to have all the top industry land guys plus myself out there for 2 days, just telling everything we're doing in land and driving supercars. So if you can jump up, if you can attend that, it's in June in Denver. That's the best time to be in. That's the best time to be in Colorado anyway.
Use a little scarcity now and get me to pay you right now. You know, you missed out on this.
Yeah.
You might miss out on the next one. You wouldn't want to put some, this is called the skin in the game move. We kind of talked about that earlier. Get close me right now on that phone call and make money while you're taking a jog in Florida there.
You know, Claude, I'm actually about to put this out to my Landsharks community. We have a few spots left. But if you want to go ahead and purchase your tickets right now, that might be the only way you secure your seat. Is that something you'd want to do now so you don't miss out again?
You mean if that June thing will get filled up like the May one that I wanted to go to?
Yeah, it's going to happen probably this evening. Drop the link in the chat as well as a promo code for you because I really like you. Use my name to get $500 off.
Can I give you a credit card now, or can I go in there right now, or text you? Can I send you a Zelle or something like that?
You know, I'm actually on a walk right now, but yeah, go ahead with your credit card. I'll secure your spot.
Boom. How cool. Tell me how cool that would be to sign up somebody while you're taking your morning walk. What emotional.
It happens.
Yes. What emotional trigger did Brent use so well there? What did he use? My favorite one.
Scarcity.
Scarcity. Everybody together. 1, 2, 3. Scarcity. How powerful is, Justin, you got to chime in on, how powerful is scarcity when you're talking to people like Brent just did? How powerful is that?
Everybody wants what they can't have. Ooh, or what they're afraid they might, what they're afraid they might lose out the opportunity to have. So everybody wants what they cannot have or can't, or they're afraid they can't get.
Is that powerful? If you play it right, like Brent was like pushing me, sorry, we're full. I was begging him, literally begging him. I told him I'd even stay in the back room, and the more he told me I couldn't have what I wanted, the more I wanted it, didn't I? Do you think real estate, you think those of us in real estate, do you think we could use that scarcity strategy too?
Absolutely.
Hey, Justin, I just wanted to make sure you were on the, you were on that real estate group thing on Facebook. Did you get my mind map about land investment? I just wanted to make sure. I hope you don't mind me calling you.
I did. I got that. Okay. Good. Thank you for that.
Oh, that's great, man. Listen, how long you been? Are you just getting into land? Before I go, I'm very busy today. But before I go, have you invested in land before? Have you done anything like that, or you've been years of experience?
Yeah, I haven't invested in raw land before. No.
Oh, okay.
But I'm interested in it because of the passive income that it creates.
Oh, when you say passive income, what's the dream?
Well, my dream is to get paid every single day of my life. I know that sounds really far out, but you know, when I hear you guys talk about how you've got your businesses running, it makes me want to have that too.
And what would you need to, what do you do for a living now?
Right now I'm an investor, but in the pretty house, I just do pretty houses. So, you know, like I'm assigning all of my deals. And so that means I get nice big shots in the arm. I make nice big checks, but then I have to start over tomorrow.
Oh, okay. And you said the passive income. What kind of passive income? Where are you now? Where would you like to be in terms of passive income? If you don't mind me asking before I leave.
Right now, I don't have a lot of passive income, but I would love to have, like I said, like I saw Brent the other day. He's got money coming in like every day.
Yeah. What do you mean? $100, $1,000 a day, $5,000, $20,000 a month?
I mean, anywhere from $20 to $2,000. I mean, that would, you know, it all adds up. It's kind of like, you know, getting something every day. It really, really stacks up quick.
If you got to, let's say, $2,500, $5,000 a month, just for starters, how would that wouldn't change your life, would it?
Oh, well, yeah, definitely. And better than that, learning the process of how to make it happen so I can just rinse and repeat. Yes.
Can you imagine if you found a system where you could find the properties, you could finance them, you could assign them, wholesale them, you could hold on to a few and watch them appreciate on that? I don't know. That may not be what you're looking for.
That is exactly what I'm looking for.
What am I, my students out there, what good role play. What am I doing here? Am I giving him a presentation or just asking questions with a little imagery? How important is it to put the ideas, the pictures in their head and to get those needs and greeds? How important is that? It's huge. Yeah. Just going back to what Nitzan said, though, I called up Justin before. Do I have, when I give answers on social media, when I give things away, when I give people my time for consultation, do I have the right, the tacit approval is the legal term, to call them back or to text them or to initiate a contact? Do I have that right? Isn't it easy to call somebody back? Corey DiGiacomo. Hey, Corey, I just wanted to make sure you asked a question on Facebook the other day, and I thank you, and I sent you some stuff and everything. Did I answer your question okay?
Yeah, I was trying to get some information, so I was wanted to reach out and see if I could get some time.
Why are you interested in solar heating and everything like that? I was just curious. Why did you bring that up?
I've just been looking at different opportunities, different kind of vetting different people and trying to get information.
Okay, boom. Is this, we're out of time here, but do you see what we're, is this an easy, who loves easy warm phone calls? Everybody, right? Okay, who wants to do cold calls? I don't mind taking a cold call and making it into a warm call. But when I have somebody that I met online, and I get back to them, and we can use LinkedIn and all these different social media, and you can leave voicemails too. We talk about that all the time. You have to leave the guts style voicemail so you get a very, we get a high percentage of return calls if you leave the right voicemail. But when you're when you're giving away information or participating online, maybe 30 minutes a day, you can develop your own warm call lead system. And these calls are so much more fun. There's no pressure when you're coming back, when you're calling somebody back to ask for their opinion, make sure they got the product or service. Hey, did I answer your question? Is there about 20 different ways to open a conversation with somebody? And where can that lead to? A sale.
Business.
Sale.
Hey, Claude, one thing I'm going to start doing more of, which I don't see anybody else doing this, is doing actual deals live personally with my team, actually showing the ins and outs and the things we go through as deal creators and deal makers and deal finders. You know, that's, you could probably get more leads than you want that way, as far as people wanting to come into your program. If you physically do deals live, show what you're spending, what you're putting as far as time. And also what you make, you know, some people just think it's magic or it's not attainable, but I think just being vulnerable like that is going to get more potential applications for your program.
And what happens if, and that's a really honest way. See, your competition, pardon the expression, does not have the guts to do that, because what can happen on those live phone calls?
Yeah, you can make a mistake, a huge mistake, big mistakes, or you can, like, I just made a huge mistake the other day on a land deal, and I'm sharing it. It's public. I'm going to hopefully dig my way out of it, but I'm sharing it. I just hired an attorney last week. I had to spend money on a piece of land that could be worthless now because I made a simple mistake.
Yeah. I think people are looking for accountability. They're looking, I think too many of our competitors out there are not giving people the customer service they want, the accountability, the follow-up that they're looking for. I love follow-up, okay? Certain things, it's not always about the price, is it? Isn't it about that somebody has your back and you feel good about them? How big is that in making commitments? When they feel so good about you and the services you provide and you follow up with them right away. Okay. Has anybody here ever contacted a contractor? Oh, I got a my car lease. Okay, I lease a car every 2 years. Okay, I sent a couple dealerships. Hey, I knew the make and model and everything, and I said, here's my phone number and everything else. Do you know two of the car dealerships never got back to me, and I gave them my phone number? Can you imagine that? I mean, that to me, that's crazy. You have a customer who contacts you, and then you're so scared to giving good phone that you want to text. You cannot text an email all day long in your marketing. There's a lot of people who want that direct communication, and you can control it. Wow, we had a great session. Didn't it go fast? Good session today, guys. Thank you so much for the participation and stuff. And I made an offer to anybody who watches this. They want my brand new attraction marketing book. Some of the things we talked about today, you can attract warm leads. I'm giving it away for free. Just send me a text. See, I practice what I preach. Pretty sneaky, huh? 619-206-5960. Joseph, you got $1 million smile there. But everybody, thanks for sharing. And I'll see you guys next Monday. Okay. Take care. Have a good week. Make some money. Make a lot of money.
Have a good one, Claude.
Have a good one, guys. Let me get some good music here. Here we go. Trying. Let's see. Wonder why that's not playing. Oh, well. No music, sorry. I can sing though. See you guys later.